Item number, SCP-458. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-458 is considered safe, and therefore is to be stored in the staff canteen at Site 17, with no access restrictions required. Description: SCP-458 is a large-sized pizza box from the pizza chain Little Caesars, of their hot and ready variety. It is made of simple cardboard, measures 25.4 centimeters by 25.4 centimeters by 2.54 centimeters, 10 inches by 10 inches by 1 inch, and weighs about 20 to 20.49 grams, depending on toppings. As a result of the unusual nature of SCP-458, measurement of weight is inconsistent. What makes SCP-458 an oddity is that, while appearing to be an ordinary pizza box, when it comes into contact with human hands, it instantaneously replicates within it the holder's subconsciously preferred choice of pizza, down to the favorite sauce, cheese, crust, and topping. It is not limited to the Little Caesars brand, as pizza from all major pizza chains, as well as local and even handmade pizzas, have been produced. There seems to be no limit to its ability, except that it cannot make anything but pizza, and its toppings must be edible by normal human standards. The box is also rather indestructible, as all tests to destroy or dismantle the box have proven fruitless. It is assumed the box is semi-sentient, having at least enough telepathic or empathetic ability to sense what the holder's personal choices regarding pizza are. After constant testing showed SCP-458's seemingly infinite power to generate pizza, but with little other use, it has henceforth been placed inside the canteen at Site 17 for free use by personnel. After its open usage has been allowed, personnel morale has shown to have sharply increased. Addendum 1A. Upon testing SCP-458 with SCP, the subject took a bite of the slice, which appeared to be a garlic-free slice of sausage and olive pizza on wheat crust. This was met with the response, "It's a fine slice, but I would have preferred a rather different sauce." It was inferred that the box cannot use substances that are indigestible by regular human bodies. Further testing confirmed this. Addendum 1B. Document number 458-1A. I would just like to remind all staff that just because we have a pizza box that can constantly create pizzas for you does not mean that you can just sit around and eat pizza all afternoon. If continued abuse of the box continues, coupled with reports of personnel gaining unhealthy amounts of weight, I may be forced to implement a mandatory physical training regimen following lunch hours. Dr. Del Marino. Document number 458-1B. For simple curiosity's sake, and to, perhaps, get a better idea of the mindset of certain SCPs, I have compiled a list of sentient SCPs' reactions when holding the box. SCP. SCP-40. Result: small, extra cheese, cheese-stuffed crust. SCP. SCP-56. Result: medium, sliced bell peppers, thin crust, Alfredo sauce. SCP. SCP-73. Result: medium, feta and jack cheese, no sauce, thin crust. Note: almost immediately after opening SCP-458, the produced pizza began to go through symptoms similar to other organic material within SCP-73's effect radius. Experiment was retried, with the pizza being removed from SCP-458 immediately after its opening, with minor deterioration present. When queried by researchers, SCP-73 stated it had never ingested products created by SCP-458. SCP. SCP-76-2. Result: large, meatballs, pepperoni, bacon, Canadian bacon, sausage, hamburger, thick crust. SCP. SCP-105. Result: small, olives, wheat crust, thin. SCP. SCP-108-1. Result: large, pepperoni, thick crust. SCP-134. Result: small, onions, anchovies, olives, thin crust. SCP-166. Result: small, bell peppers, olives, thin crust. Note: after SCP-166 ate a slice of pizza from SCP-458, SCP-166 complained about occasional moderate discomfort and nausea. The effects stopped after approximately 20 hours. SCP-181. Result: large, pepperoni, sausage, marinara stuffed crust. Note: SCP-181 was told that this was a reward for good behavior, and that it was a lucky guess that it was his favorite type of pizza. SCP-182. Result: medium, olives, mushrooms, pretzel dough crust. SCP-343. Result: large, almost every topping imaginable, with over 100 distinct foods identified. SCP-378, SCP-378-1. Result: SCP-378-1 produced a large thin crust pizza with pesto sauce, ricotta, mushrooms, and fried mealworms. SCP-378 itself could not activate SCP-458. SCP-3301. Result: large extra cheese and pepperoni, wet when removed from box. SCP-3477. Result: medium, anchovies. All instances produced identical pizzas, with identically arranged toppings. Subject: Dr. Michaels. Result: large, Hawaiian, tomato sauce, honey-baked ham, pineapple, extra mozzarella cheese, with Tabasco. SCP-4504. Result: medium, egg, bacon, barbecue sauce base, thick crust. SCP-4999. Result: extra large, half supreme, half pepperoni. Note: SCP-4999 shared the pizza with D-430276, who was suffering from end-stage renal disease. Notably, this was the same variety D-430276 frequently shared with her late partner, and the first known case of SCP-458 accommodating a pizza which exceeds its volume. SCP-POI-3445, SCP-5175-1. Result: wielding SCP-5175, POI-3445 produced large pizza with mozzarella cheese stuffed crust, a barbecue sauce base, bacon bits, bacon strips, ground beef, ham, pepperoni, sausage, and a dusting of crushed chili cheese Fritos. SCP-5175-1 contributed teriyaki sauce. Note: through POI-3445, SCP-5175-1 claims to have never tasted teriyaki sauce. It emerged as a modern fusion recipe and is not traditional Japanese cuisine. SCP-5175-1 acquired a liking for the sauce after conversation with POI-3445, who regularly ordered chicken teriyaki at the marketplace at Steamtown's food court. Further testing on SCPs may reveal some odd characteristics about the SCPs themselves, and is suggested. Dr. Crane. Update: further cross-testing is permitted, but requires approval and supervision due to safety concerns. Dr. Item number: SCP-348. Object class: safe. Special containment procedures: SCP-348 is to be kept in a standard locker at Site 19. Personnel wishing to conduct tests involving SCP-348 are to obtain Level 3 or higher authorization. and present a detailed list of intended test subjects. Description: SCP-348 is a white ceramic bowl, patterned with light blue flowers, measuring approximately 20 centimeters in diameter and 9 centimeters high. While no maker's marks are present, the Chinese characters for "thinking of you" are etched into the side of the bowl. When in the presence of an individual afflicted with a minor ailment or injury, i.e. mild cough, runny nose, or scrapes, SCP-348 will fill with soup. While the ingredients present within the soups produced by SCP-348 vary, young subjects, individuals between the ages of 4 and 18, have consistently stated that they enjoyed the meal, sometimes stating that it reminds them of their parents' cooking. Subjects will finish the soup found in SCP-348 if allowed. Children who eat from SCP-348 several times often express a feeling of contentment, stating that though they are eating by themselves, they do not feel lonely. Addendum: SCP-348-1. SCP-348 was acquired shortly after rumors of a child living in, apparently possessing remarkable recovery abilities, came to the Foundation's attention. Investigation revealed that the child in question originally discovered SCP-348 in the attic of their house, and had come to rely on it after receiving insufficient attention from their parents. The child's parents, both full-time workers, refused to comment on their relationship with the child. Resulting testing involving children was carried out under the guise of surveys to gauge the success of new food items offered at public schools. Addendum: SCP-348-2. It has been noted that, occasionally, after soup produced by SCP-348 has been consumed, a message will materialize on the inside of the bowl. Words produced on the inside of the bowl appear to be printed on the ceramic consistent with existing markings. The message that appears will be in the language most familiar to the drinker of the soup. After several hours, or when SCP-348 produces another meal, the words disappear. Testing log: SCP-348-1323. Subject: 8-year-old female, afflicted with sore throat. Brief background: lives with and is on good terms with both parents. Notes: subject took approximately 30 minutes to consume soup, remarked later that sore throat seemed to have gone away. Subject: 10-year-old male, recently injured self while biking, minor bruising. Brief background: lives with both parents, often argues with both. Notes: message appeared: don't forget to brush. Subject: 11-year-old male, afflicted with slight cold. Brief background: lives with foster parents. Notes: message appeared: I'm glad you're happy. Subject: 9-year-old female, afflicted with slight cold. Brief background: lives with both parents, said to be prone to tantrums. Notes: nothing of note occurred during or immediately after testing. Subject stated while she didn't particularly care for the soup after tasting it, she still wanted to eat it. Follow-up investigations revealed that the subject recovered from the cold faster than was expected. Subject: 6-year-old male, recently injured self while playing with friends, minor scrapes and scratches. Brief background: parents divorced, currently lives with mother. Notes: message appeared: I'm sorry, son. Subject: 7-year-old female, afflicted with cough. Brief background: lives with mother and grandmother, father deceased, traffic accident. Notes: message appeared: I love you. Addendum: SCP-348-3. Testing has revealed that in the event that someone older than 18 years of age attempts to consume soup created by SCP-348, the individual will find that they are less inclined to finish the meal. Some such individuals will remark that something is missing. Most will simply state that the soup was nothing out of the ordinary. Further studies carried out with older subjects indicate that though messages will appear for individuals older than 18, the appearance of the messages is worn and faded. Testing log: SCP-348-2635. Note: it was observed that though over 100 subjects were tested, only 4 individuals received messages from SCP-348. Subject: 30-year-old female, afflicted with headache. Brief background: on poor terms with both parents. Refused to accept father's offer for career training. Currently lives alone. Notes: message appeared. Why? Subject: 35-year-old male, afflicted with cough. Brief background: parents divorced. Visits father and stepmother once a month. Does not visit mother on her insistence. Notes: message appeared. It'll get better. Subject: 40-year-old female, afflicted with sore throat. Brief background: moved away and became estranged from both parents. Nevertheless, sent money and took care of senior housing for both. Father recently passed away. Notes: subject noted the soup tasted initially bitter, but was fulfilling in the end. Message appeared. Thank you. Subject: 40-year-old male, afflicted with minor backaches. Brief background: murdered father approximately 1 year ago. Notes: subject tasted and then refused to consume soup, complaining about the taste. Subject later developed mild stomach pains. After the contents of SCP-348 were disposed of, SCP-348 immediately filled with what appeared to be salt water, which remained for 3 hours before disappearing. Subject: 45-year-old male, afflicted with aches due to arthritis. Brief background: happily married, lives with wife and children. Visits father once a week, with family. Mother deceased. Notes: message appeared. I'm proud of you. Despite the extensive data gathered in testing, it is unknown whether the messages that SCP-348 has manifested originate from the fathers of the subjects, or SCP-348 itself. Addendum: SCP-348-4. SCP-348 was once used in a test involving a 60-year-old man suffering from a terminal illness. The subject, a grandfather with multiple grandchildren, stated that the soup produced by SCP-348 was the best he'd ever tasted. Following the test, the subject reported feeling a sense of satisfaction and noted that the pain caused by the illness seemed to have faded. The subject passed away peacefully a week later. Item number: SCP-330. Object class: safe. Special containment procedures: considering recent incidents, SCP-330 is to be kept in secure storage until further notice. Level 2 clearance is required for access to SCP-330 or its contents. All direct experimentation of SCP-330 is to be conducted using Class D personnel with no genetic history of diabetes. No more than 2 samples are to be removed from SCP-330 at any time, except during exposure testing. Description: SCP-330 appears to be a small, round, stainless steel bowl filled with a variable amount of individually wrapped pieces of candy. Taped to the side of the bowl is a handwritten note, reading, "Take no more than 2, please." Attempts to remove the note have met with failure, as have attempts to hide or obscure it. Testers have noted finding it impossible to avoid reading the note, and those who approach it from an opposite angle are aware of this request. When a quantity of candy greater than 2 pieces is removed, regardless of the means involved, the offender instantly has both hands severed at the wrists by an unknown method. Tests involving remote manipulation by Class D personnel resulted in the operator's hands being removed, despite no direct contact. Inspection of the incision reveals that the cut is made at a molecular level, leaving no tool marks or identifying factors. It is to be noted that the third piece must be removed within a certain time frame. After 24 hours, the count resets, and additional candy can be removed. Discovered 3 days after Halloween of 2000, when a police investigation into what was believed to be a case of ritualistic dismemberment was launched, SCP-330 was seized as evidence, but all attending officers were killed after Officer emptied the bowl of its contents. The cause of death was a result of data expunged. Foundation agents, under the guise of federal agents, recovered the object with acceptable casualties. Addendum: due to continuing security issues, SCP-330 will be held in Dr. Kondraki's office when not required for testing. Experiment. Name: Researcher Vogt. Date: undisclosed. Subject D33001, a double amputee equipped with prosthetic forearms and hands, was told to remove 3 pieces of candy from the bowl. Subject complied, with no immediate effects. However, within 45 seconds, subject reported a burning itch from both his arm stumps, right arm, 2 centimeters below elbow, left arm, 1.5 centimeters below elbow, and phantom pains from both his absent wrists. Subject's distress at this discomfort increased rapidly. Within 180 seconds of having removed the 3rd candy from the bowl, the subject began forcibly removing both his own prostheses. Upon hurling the prostheses to the ground, subject reported that the discomfort had ceased. Dermatological examination of subject's stumps revealed no unusual irritation or inflammation. Mechanical examination of subject's prostheses revealed that, in addition to the physical damage sustained by being hurled to the ground, the prostheses had data expunged. Subject was supplied with fresh prostheses, identical to the first pair, but reported feeling that it was wrong to put them on. Coercion was applied, and subject reluctantly put on left prosthesis. Note: subject is right-handed. However, when told to put on right prosthesis, subject began weeping incoherently and flailing his arms until the left prosthesis detached itself. Analysis of video footage revealed that subject had not properly attached the left prosthesis to his stump. Mechanical examination of left prosthesis revealed only physical damage sustained from being thrown across the room. 24 hours later, subject was given fresh prostheses and reported no difficulty in putting them on. Subject not terminated, as D-class amputees who are already used to their prostheses are in short supply. Item number: SCP-241. Object class: safe. Special containment procedures: SCP-241 is to be kept at Site-19 using standard operating procedures for containing safe class book and manuscript type SCPs, with the following additional conditions. SCP-241 must be kept open on a flat surface, with restraints across opposing pages of the open book to keep it from closing accidentally. Containment devices must be checked at least once a week for structural integrity. Any anomalies must be reported immediately to Site Command. Access to SCP-241 is restricted. Any and all usage of SCP-241 must be logged. SCP-241 must be transported in an authorized book stand, such that it cannot accidentally be closed in transit. In the event that SCP-241 is opened outside of a testing environment, the last person to have touched it must report to the nearest infirmary, and a D-class personnel must close and reopen SCP-241. Description: SCP-241 appears as a normal book, 33 centimeters by 23 centimeters by 3.5 centimeters, entitled Good Home Cooking. The cover of SCP-241 is a red and white checkerboard pattern with the title in simple black letters on the front and spine. When open, SCP-241 contains 99 recipes, sorted into typical sections of a cookbook. Many of these recipes include a picture of the dish that is invariably appetizing, and a small percentage will call for rare or exotic ingredients. Whenever SCP-241 is opened by a subject, known as the target, different from the one who last opened it, i.e. the previous target, the recipes contained in the book change. Preliminary investigations concluded that if the target eats a dish prepared from one of the recipes in SCP-241, that person soon dies from apparent anaphylactic shock. Others who eat the same dish are not similarly affected. Testing has been authorized to determine the exact nature of SCP-241's effects. SCP-241 appears to be impervious to getting dirty and to at least minor damage. For example, sauces splashed onto its pages disappear almost immediately, and torn pages and nicks on the cover are repaired within seconds. Research on SCP-241 continues, including potential interaction with other SCP items. Experiment Log 241-L02. Supplemental testing on SCP-241. Just as in initial testing, All tests on SCP-241 were carried out in test kitchens at Site-19, using D-class personnel for test subjects, unless otherwise indicated. Test 241-21. Subject. Subject 241-J was chosen from general population. Health screenings indicate subject is allergic to peanuts. Procedure. Subject was instructed to close and open SCP-241 several times at prescribed intervals. Each time SCP-241 was opened, the complete contents of SCP-241 were recorded and transcribed while subject underwent testing. Results. Test results indicated the subject's allergy to peanuts worsened each time subject opened SCP-241. Subject's allergy was most affected the first time he opened SCP-241, and subsequently opening SCP-241 appears to have diminishing effects. However, subject's allergy worsened from mild to severe. Most of the recipes in SCP-241 reappeared when subject closed and reopened SCP-241. Between 11 and 17 inclusive new recipes appeared each time SCP-241 was reopened. Recipes that had been replaced did not reappear. Only one exotic recipe was replaced after subject had opened SCP-241 for the fourth time. Analysis. The effects of SCP-241 appear to follow the law of diminishing returns. SCP-241 also appears to tailor its choice of recipes to the specific condition of the target, though much more testing would be necessary to prove that theory. Suggest analysis of recipes offered during normal testing of SCP-241. Test 241-22. Subject. Subject 241-K is a rhesus monkey. Health screenings indicated no apparent food allergies or other health problems. Procedure. Subject was introduced to SCP-241 and encouraged to open it by handlers. Handlers were instructed to keep subject from closing SCP-241 again. Results. Subject eventually opened SCP-241, and handlers kept it open for analysis. The contents of SCP-241 were consistent with previous results for a target with a shellfish allergy, though again unique for the target. Testing confirmed subject had developed an allergy to shellfish. A dish was prepared from SCP-241 by Subject 241-F and presented to Subject 241-K. Subject 241-K ate the meal without hesitation, and 9 minutes later was dead from anaphylactic shock, consistent with previous testing. Analysis. SCP-241 is just as effective on certain non-humans as it is on humans. The working theory now is that SCP-241 works on anything potentially susceptible to food allergies that can and does open SCP-241. Test 241-23. Subject. Subject 241-L is a robot designed for remote manipulation of hazardous materials. Procedure. Subject was remote controlled by who was instructed to have the subject open SCP-241. Results. Subject opened SCP-241 via remote control. The contents of SCP-241 were identical to before it was closed previously. Analysis. SCP-241 apparently does not respond to inorganic targets. Test 241-24. Subject. Subject 241-M/859E was chosen from general population. Health screenings indicated no allergies. Procedure. Subject was exposed to SCP-859 via touch. Subject then placed within an MOPP-4 containment suit. Subject was given SCP-241 and instructed to open it and to keep it open. Results. Tests on skin sample taken from subject confirmed development of severe allergy to spider venom, as per usual with contact with SCP-859. SCP-241 retained its previous set of recipes. Analysis. SCP-241 apparently requires physical contact with subject. Test 241-25. Subject. Subject 241-M/859E. Procedure. Subject given a standard Class D uniform. Subject was given SCP-241 and instructed to open it. Results. Subject dropped SCP-241 to the floor and began screaming. Subject given a mild sedative. SCP-241 contained a set of arachnid-based and themed recipes. The meal, Mr. Skeleton's Halloween Spider Snacks, was selected and prepared from SCP-241 by Subject 241F. Due to Subject 241M/859E having severe arachnophobia, data expunged. Within 2 minutes, the subject experienced breathing difficulties and partial paralysis. This was closely followed by the typical symptoms of anaphylaxis. Immediate administration of epinephrine did not prevent the subject from expiring. Analysis. Although the images found in SCP-241 are typically considered pleasing or appetizing, it does not seem to have any particular sentience. Autopsy confirmed the presence of venom and neurotoxins produced by the Brazilian wandering spider. End experiment log. Directive 241-S06. In light of recent test results with SCP-241, no further testing of SCP-241 on personnel without pre-existing food allergies is authorized, without Level 4 security clearance. Testing may continue on personnel with pre-existing food allergies. 05. Directive 241-S09. Reclassification of SCP-241 to Euclid class is denied. Honestly, the cookbook? Leave it in its room and everything's fine. It's no one else's fault if you don't know what you're allergic to and don't bother to find out beforehand. Unless you're cooking for your significant other, then you'd better know. 05. Directive 241-S11. Cross-testing SCP-241 with other SCPs will be considered on a case-by-case basis. Exposure to SCP-682 has already been considered and denied. 05. Addendum 1. Acquisition Summary. The Foundation became aware of SCP-241 in April 2000 while investigating reports of a Black Widow in. Said subject had been married 4 times, and all 4 of her husbands had died shortly after eating a meal at home. However, since authorities never found evidence of foul play, subject was never charged with any crime. Subsequent interviews with subject by Foundation personnel revealed the existence of SCP-241, at which time SCP-241 was seized by Foundation agents. Subject revealed that she had first realized there was something unusual with SCP-241 when data expunged. Addendum 2. Initial Testing Log. All tests on SCP-241 were carried out in test kitchens at Site 19, using D-class personnel for test subjects, unless otherwise noted. Test 241-1. Subject. Subject 241A was chosen from general population. No unusual traits selected for. Procedure. Subject 241A was presented SCP-241 while closed, and instructed to open it, choose a recipe, prepare it, and eat it, while giving feedback during the entire process. Results. Before exposure to SCP-241, subject declared that he had never cooked anything more complicated than ramen noodles. Subject opened SCP-241, reporting nothing unusual. Subject looked through recipes in SCP-241, choosing sautéed scallops in a white wine sauce. Subject prepared the sautéed scallops from the recipe in SCP-241, and when complete, remarked that he did not know he could do that. Subject declared that the prepared dish smelled fantastic, and while eating it, declared, "This is the best thing I've ever eaten." 3 minutes after completing the meal, subject started showing symptoms of anaphylactic shock. Subject was treated with emergency doses of epinephrine, but treatment was not effective. Subject died from anaphylactic shock 6 minutes afterward, later confirmed by autopsy. A subsequent examination of SCP-241 revealed that 81 of its recipes called for shellfish. SCP-241 was left open. Analysis. Results are consistent with previous descriptions of the effects of SCP-241. Test 241-2. Subject. Subject 241B was chosen from general population. Subject reports no known allergies to scallops or other shellfish. Procedure. SCP-241 was still open from test 241-1. Subject 241B was instructed to not close SCP-241 find the sautéed scallops recipe, prepare it, and eat it, while giving feedback during the entire process. Results. Before exposure to SCP-241, subject expressed doubt that he'd be able to prepare the sautéed scallops recipe. After preparing the dish, subject expressed surprise that he had done so, similarly to the reaction of Subject 241A, and said that the dish smells pretty good. While eating, subject declared that the dish was pretty good, and again expressed surprise that he had cooked it. Subject did not suffer anaphylactic shock or any other adverse effect after completing the meal. Post-testing observation of subject revealed no long-term effects from eating the dish. SCP-241 was left open. Analysis. Results are consistent with previous descriptions of the effects of SCP-241. Suspect that SCP-241 may somehow improve the cooking skill of whoever is preparing the dish. Test 241-3. Subject. Subjects 241C and 241D were chosen from general population. Both subjects report no skill in cooking and no allergies to shellfish. Procedure. SCP-241 was still open from test 2412. Subject 241C was instructed to not close SCP-241, find the sautéed scallops recipe, and transcribe it to a standard sheet of paper. In a separate test kitchen, Subject 241D was given the transcribed recipe and instructed to prepare and eat the dish prepared. Results. Subject 241C found and transcribed the recipe without incident. The transcribed recipe was visually compared to the recipe in SCP-241 and confirmed to be identical. SCP-241 was left open. Subject displayed no adverse effects from interaction with SCP-241. Subject 241D was given the transcribed recipe and attempted to prepare the sautéed scallops, but experienced difficulty and frustration, several times declaring, "I told you guys I can't cook." The completed dish did not look or smell nearly as good as in previous tests. Subject balked at eating the dish, saying that it smells like but was persuaded to eat it. Subject ate approximately 40% of the meal before stating, "I'm gonna be sick," at which time subject vomited. Subject was instructed to finish the meal, but subject responded, "Data expunged." Termination of subject considered, but rejected, in favor of further testing. Analysis. More evidence that SCP-241 can improve the cooking skill of its user. Subject 241D retained for further testing. Test 241-4. Subject. Subject 241D. Procedure. SCP-241 was still open from test 241-3. Subject 241D was instructed to not close SCP-241, find the sautéed scallops recipe, prepare it, and eat it, while giving feedback during the entire process. Results. Subject vociferously protested to having to eat her own cooking, but was persuaded to cooperate, with the promise that subject would not have to eat the resultant dish if it turned out like in the previous test. Subject expressed skepticism, but proceeded to prepare the sautéed scallops recipe. While cooking the dish, subject experienced none of the difficulties she experienced from the previous test, instead expressing the now familiar surprise that her cooking was turning out so well. The completed dish looked and smelled similar to the results of test 241-2. The subject was not nearly as reluctant to eat the prepared dish, declaring it, "Not bad. Not bad at all." Subject did not appear to suffer from any adverse effects after eating the dish. During post-testing interviews, subject was asked how she was able to prepare the sautéed scallops during this test, when the results of the previous test were so unappetizing. Subject stated that she did not know, only that once she started cooking the dish, it became perfectly clear to her how to do it. Subject did not appear to have any additional knowledge of cooking, and even had trouble remembering the cooking techniques she used in this test. Analysis. There is now little doubt that SCP-241 can turn people who know nothing about cooking into gourmet chefs, at least for the dish that's being prepared. Test 241-11. Subject. Subjects 241E and 241F were chosen from general population. Subject 241E is known to have an allergy to peanuts. Subject 241F has demonstrated considerable skill as a chef. Procedure: Subject 241E was presented with SCP-241 while closed and instructed to open it and choose a recipe. Subject 241F was then instructed to prepare the selected meal from SCP-241. The prepared dish was given to Subject 241E, who was then asked to eat it. Results: Subject 241E opened SCP-241 and, while looking through the recipes offered, stated that all the recipes called for peanuts, adding, "Peanuts mess me up something fierce." Subject found a few recipes that did not include peanuts, and selected an Australian carrot cake. Subject 241F prepared the carrot cake from SCP-241 and remarked that the finished product was better than he expected. The cake was presented to Subject 241E, who started eating without prompting or hesitation. Subject stated that the cake was the best thing I've ever eaten, and ate nearly half the cake before claiming satiation. Within 2 minutes, subject started showing symptoms of anaphylactic shock. Subject was administered epinephrine, which was ineffective, and died 4 minutes later. Autopsy confirmed anaphylactic shock as the cause of death. The recipes in SCP-241 were examined, and 85 of the 99 recipes called for peanuts or peanut products, but the Australian carrot cake was not one of them. The carrot cake and 7 other recipes included lupin flour. A quick search found that lupin flour can induce an anaphylactic reaction in those who suffer from peanut allergies. The remaining 6 recipes called for more exotic ingredients. SCP-241 remained open. The remaining half of the cake was saved for further testing. Analysis: Reactions of subjects 241E and 241F were both consistent with prior observations. The selection of recipes supports the theory that SCP-241 somehow determines the substance that the target is most allergic to, and offers recipes to specifically induce a fatal allergic reaction in the target. Test 241-12. Subject: Subject 241F. Procedure: Subject 241F was instructed to prepare the 6 dishes that contained neither peanuts nor lupin flour. The dishes were turned over for analysis. The 6 recipes were transcribed. Results: Data expunged. Analysis: Data expunged. Subject 241F showed no apparent ill effects from preparing 7 different dishes from SCP-241 in quick succession. Recommended retaining subject to study long-term effects of secondary, i.e. not as the target, exposure to SCP-241. Test 241-13. Subject: Subject 241G was chosen from general population and is known to have an allergy to peanuts. Procedure: Subject was instructed to eat the remaining cake from test 241-11. Results: Subject asked if the cake contained peanuts, and was assured that it did not. Subject stated that he didn't much like carrot cake. Subject started eating the cake, remarking that the cake was pretty good actually. Subject consumed approximately 75% of the remaining cake before declaring satiation. After 7 minutes, subject started showing signs of anaphylactic shock. Epinephrine was administered, and subject was stabilized. Subject eventually recovered, although recovery time was somewhat longer than expected. Analysis: It appears that, although the recipes from SCP-241 are potentially hazardous to anyone susceptible to the allergen in question, SCP-241's recipes are most potent against the target. Test 241-14. Subject: Subject 241H was chosen from general population. According to complete health screenings, subject has no food allergies. Procedure: Subject was instructed to open SCP-241 and leave it open for analysis. Results: Analysis of SCP-241 showed that 79 of the recipes on its pages called for chicken eggs or egg-based products. 15 of the remaining recipes called for eggs. The other 5 recipes, data expunged. These 5 recipes were transcribed. Subject 241H stated that she had never experienced any problems eating eggs before. Subject was presented with 1 dozen hard-boiled chicken eggs and was instructed to eat them, Subject asked for salt and pepper, granted, and proceeded to eat the eggs. While eating the third egg, subject started complaining of stomach pain. Subject was instructed to continue eating, and she begrudgingly continued. Upon ingesting her seventh egg, subject collapsed on the floor, doubled over in pain. Within 60 seconds, subject started showing signs of anaphylactic shock. Epinephrine was administered, and subject was stabilized. Subject recovered, within the expected recovery time for such an episode. Analysis. We now have evidence that SCP-241 somehow induces or amplifies an allergy in the target when SCP-241 is opened. This ability would explain how SCP-241 is able to cause an allergic reaction in targets without pre-existing food allergies. Addendum 3. Notes from cross-testing. To determine the effects of SCP-241's recipes on subjects that either cannot eat or do not require sustenance, approval was given to cross-test SCP-241 on SCP-1770. Upon subject opening the book, the contents were identical to before it was closed previously. This confirms results of test 241-23, in which SCP-241 does not respond to inorganic subjects. Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now, and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.